Recorded Books and RB Digital present The Angels Will Not Care by John Straley. Narrated by David Chandler. For my siblings, Mary, Hugh, Jane, and Martha, when I looked up, you were there. The blessed will not care what angle they are regarded from, having nothing to hide. Dear, I know nothing of either, but when I try to imagine a faultless love or the life to come, what I hear is the murmur of underground streams. What I see is a limestone landscape. In Praise of Limestone by W. H. Auden. Chapter 1. Home. Sitka, Alaska. Summer. It was coming down to the last months of the 20th century, and I couldn't wait for the parties to end, particularly since it didn't seem I had been invited to any of them. It had been 2 months since the shooting, and I still hadn't shaken off my bad mood. Whether I was to blame or not had never really been decided, but when I saw my friends downtown in the bookstore or in the coffee shop, they would pat the outside of their pockets, then look at their watches and mumble excuses as quickly as they could. This is only partially to explain why I was crouched in a wet salmonberry bush watching a chicken coop through my foggy binoculars. My feet were wet and my legs were cramping. The rain dribbled down on me like warm beer. I had thought of giving private investigations up before, but never with as much seriousness as this. It was the middle of August, and we had had now only 3 sunny days all summer long. Those days had been emeralds of sparkling green water and blue sky. Gray rock, white snow, and the lush blanket of trees running down the steep-sided mountains to the tidelands. Those sunny days were actually cruel because the rest of the summer had been so wet. Warm and mild, no dramatic storms, only low clouds closing off the mountains and pebbling the surface of the shallow puddles with rain. It had been on one of the only clear emerald days that Grant McGowan had taken a gun and held it to his fiancée's head out on the back deck of his derelict boat moored in Thompson Harbor. He told the first policeman on scene that he wanted to talk to me. Grant had been a mill worker before the pulp mill closed down. He had made a decent living working as a shill for the company's public relations crew after the shutdown. They would trot him out at hearings or in set-up articles about the impact of the mill's closeout on the community. Grant made a good, unemployed, blue-collar victim for the congressional committees that were convened to bail out the timber business. Grant was smart and hard-working, and he was living in appalling conditions on a 40-foot wooden boat that was sinking very slowly. But the truth was, Grant never lived any better when he was working. He'd always been a drinker and a fuck-up. That was how we had become close. Grant had a florid imagination that embellished every story with a kind of heartfelt drama. He wanted his tales to be more than barroom talk, more than the drama that fills every heavy metal rant and cowboy ballad. Grant wanted to be bigger than life, in real life, and as a result he lied about almost everything. It was the world, he claimed, that had kept him from realizing his true potential, the demands of making a shitty living that kept him from following his true nature. And this true nature changed with almost every sitting at the bar. Once he had grabbed me by the elbow at the bar and blared into my ear, "Canada, Younger! They've got working-class poets in Canada!" No shit, I said, and kept looking at my wobbly reflection in the bar mirror. Hell of a health care plan, too, I added. Younger, he wheeled around, stepping on the foot of a bald-headed cannery worker with five earrings in one ear. I couldn't tell if it was a man or a woman. Younger, goddammit, there's no reason I can't be a poet of the working class, too. The person with the earrings limped toward the bathrooms. I strained my neck around to check out which room this creature was headed for. Other than the fact that you're no longer a worker, I offered. We laughed, and Grant bought a round, and we toasted to working poets of Canada. The police had given me a radio hidden in a flak vest that I wore over an extra-large black raincoat. So as I walked down the dock to where Grant was holding his fiancée at gunpoint, I looked like a badly dressed umpire who was hearing voices. Grant had his arm around Vicky loosely. I would have mistaken it for a casual embrace until I saw the Ruger Blackhawk 44 with rust blotching the bluing. Grant had to cock his elbow out at an odd angle to get the long barrel to rest on her ear. Vicky's head was shaking. Her mouse brown hair hung limply to her shoulders. She had a cigarette in her right hand, but I never saw her take a draw on it. The ash fell on the painted deck. The police had briefed me. They would listen on the radio. They just wanted me to talk, keep him busy, don't argue, don't make deals or negotiate. Try and emotionally free up the situation. Avoid hard choices. They were getting their people in place. Standing in front of Grant and Vicky, I felt stupid in the clothes and the vest. I started to take the flak jacket off, and Grant became tense. What is this shit? I asked him. You want to be in Newsweek or something? This is crazy. I know you've got a gun in there, man. Grant tightened his grip on his own pistol and stood up straighter. Vicky grimaced. Her breath escaped in short, whining bursts. She dropped her cigarettes. Oh, for Christ's sake, Grant, I said, and slipped back into the vest. Like I'm going to come down here to kill you? What do I need a fucking gun for? She says she's leaving me, Younger. Vicky shook her head and shoulders, but did not speak. Well, I can't see why. I mean, you're such great company, Grant. I smiled and tried to step over the gunwale of the boat. Behind me, more police cars were rolling up into the parking lot of the Forest Service building. It was about a 75-yard shot, doable, I thought, but not preferable. Let's get out of here, man, I said, and my voice cracked. This is more trouble than either of us need, especially on such a beautiful day. I'll tell them it was a gag. Vicky, I'm sure, will back me up on this. Come on, man. We can work this out, and I bet we can watch baseball on TV. What do you say? The radio and the vest squawked. I fished for it, and Grant pulled the hammer back on the Blackhawk. Behind me, I heard police car doors slam. I heard footsteps on the gravel. I'm a fuck-up, Cecil, Grant said, and he was crying. I'm not fooling anyone. Vicky's all that matters. Oh, you're not a fuck-up, I said. If you are, what does that make me? I've been right there with you, and I'm not about to kill anybody. Oh, you got everything, man. You got a rich family, you got a sister and a girlfriend with a good business. I ain't got shit. All I got is Vicky. Grant was crying hard now. Snot rolled down his lip into the stubble of his 3-day beard. Then kill yourself, asshole, and let Vicky go. He took a deep breath, and the muscles on his arm relaxed. He smiled at me sweetly, and as I think back on it now, with some pity, then lifted the gun to his temple and fired. Vicky's hair was covered with bone and brain matter. She held her sparkling red hands out in front of her and started screaming at me. Unformed words, curses, hysterical animal sounds. Then I heard the pounding of police boots running from both ends of the dock. The radio on the vest crackled, and I heard the sarcastic voice of a police lieutenant cut through the din. "Thank you, Sigmund Freud." But now I was crouched in the wet salmonberry bushes with a small flashlight in my mouth and fogged-up binoculars in my pocket. The salmonberries sparkled in the rain, and lights from the cars on the roadway made thin lines of light breaking across the dark brush like straight pins snapping to a magnet's attention. A fat drop of water landed on the back of my collar, and I hunched my shoulders as it slid down my back. A lawyer in town had taken pity on me and offered me a job to find out who had been killing her chickens. This was the third night of the surveillance, and I was having no success in solving the problem. This was causing me to rethink my career. The chickens were safe and quiet behind the wire. I turned off the flashlight and squatted on the stump I'd covered with an old boat cushion. On my left, waves broke softly on the black granite beach, and on my right, a van with a broken muffler drove past, dolloping out the thumping chords of amplified dance music. I thought I recognized a song by Weapons of Choice. I emptied out my sealed jug of tea and stretched. I'd give it another hour. I walked down the path to the beach and looked out over the bay. Sitka sits on the outer coast of the southern Alaska panhandle. From where I stood, I could see three islands in the dark. Their forms were like the profiles of fallen animals. It was late, but the horizon still held daylight, broad streaks of silver drawn from black clouds. There was no red, only the even grays of water, stone, and unobstructed air over the ocean. I took a deep breath. The wind carried the faint smell of salt water and a hint of the cedar trees on one of those distant islands. Rain and gray light off gray water. In the distance, a passenger ship powered off out to the northwest. She was lit up like a birthday cake, moving easily on to her next port. I thought of the passengers curled down in their bunks, digesting the last of their surf and turf. I thought of having one last champagne and orange juice before falling asleep reading an overlong spy novel I had probably already read before. I cannot see ghosts. I envy those people who can, and I wish I could talk to the dead or at least hear their thoughts. Maybe then I could shake this mood. I don't know. I've done a little time in jail, and an old guy I met there told me the Indians could see more than was in the world, but white people cannot see the things that are right in front of their face. That's the way I'd been feeling all summer long, as if there must be something around me, something important that I just couldn't see. But of course I'm a white man, and that must account for my irritability. An Indian friend of mine said nothing pisses off white men like not being invited to the party, and I guess that was how I felt. All over the world, all over the island, in fact, there were parties going on, and I couldn't get into any of them. I thought of Jane Marie. She'd been living in my house for 3 years now. In the past, she'd thrown wonderful parties that were fun and calamitous, even if no one got drunk. But after the shooting, understandably, she stopped inviting people over as much. Now she was going out to picnics and potlucks on her own. She always asked me to come along, and I think she meant it, but I didn't go. This summer, we did our own chores and read our own books. I was reading books about the early Arctic expeditions, and Jane Marie was only looking at travel brochures. We had bought an extra reading light for the bed, just so we didn't have to discuss when to turn off the light. All islanders, no matter what their ethnicity, live with a certain kind of longing. It's a type of travel lust that is kept in check by fear of the unknown world. Tlingits have it. White people just make an aesthetic out of it. Living on an island is its own excuse to stay home and dream. I have lived here nearly 15 years. I was born in Juneau, which is a landlocked town on the mainland. And even if it is prone to a kind of small-town megalomania that being the capital city creates, Juneau didn't really prepare me for life in Sitka. The smaller the city in Alaska, the more tolerance is required. Gossip stings. Friends get on your nerves. Simple things cost more, and everything you hear on the news seems distant and slightly strange, as if the news was being badly translated from another language. Sitka has 8,000 people, hardly a village, and it requires about as much tolerance as I can muster. If you want to live on an island, you need either a government job or at least a couple of crummy jobs. I was a private investigator, which seemed to me to account for several crummy jobs at once. I had been working 3 cases lately, and none of them was paying much. A woman from the East Coast called and wanted me to find her old boyfriend and the father of her 10-year-old daughter. Apparently, the boyfriend was exactly 10 years behind in his child support payments. I told her I could find him, and this was true, because in fact I had just had a cup of coffee with him 2 days before at the airport. He was off to work up on the slope for an outfit that worked with some sort of geological mapping system. I told the old girlfriend this, and she thanked me, but never sent me the $50 I had suggested as my fee. I was reviewing the file on a child abuser who was begging his lawyer for post-conviction relief. I made a couple of $1,000 reading the file and re-interviewing some of the witnesses and the investigating officers, but that was the end of it. The only new trial this guy was ever going to get was in 14 years after he was released and re-offended. And then there was this dead chicken case. A handout, I knew, but still a job. In fact, my client thought one of her former clients was harassing her by breaking into the chicken coop, taking the chickens and depositing them around the neighborhood. One morning, there had been a dead chicken on her doorstep. The lawyer had brought it in to me to see what sense I could make of it. She flopped it on my desk, a white Cornish cross with a broken neck. A bird as dead as a chunk of coal, feathers swirled in a confused, rumpled pattern, dead eyes like sequins. I'm not big on the physical evidence of death. Death all looks the same to me, but that's probably because I don't like looking at it. Jane Marie has a higher tolerance concerning the subject of death. She lost a brother and a father in her childhood. She knew about spilled blood and mourning. Her mother and her sister both had gone off on the twisted path that grief sometimes presents, the mother down sadness and the sister toward anger. Jane Marie was very brave, which was both lucky and unlucky for me, I guess. I have reviewed the files of hundreds of murder cases. I've been in rooms with blood smeared down the wall and vomit in the corner. I've talked to survivors shocked and made stupid with grief, and I never really made any sense of them. In the center of each murder was a dark and sometimes casual craziness. Each death investigation was about extending the curve and getting that last glimpse of the sensible life. Imagining the final moments, the last uttered words, the concussion, and the salty taste in the mouth. So I knew the details of death, but not even the slightest truth of it. I did see my father die of a heart attack on the floor of a casino, but it happened so far away from home that his death is only a weird memory, like a movie I saw once and don't care to think of again. Grant's death was different. It happened in my own hometown, on the sunny dock where I had cleaned fish and drunk a beer at the end of a day out on the water. As I stood on the beach behind the chicken coop, I was thinking of Grant, but for some reason I thought of something I wanted to tell my father. I wanted to tell him that this wasn't my life here tangled up like half a mile of snarled fishing line in the trees, that this was just the story of my life, the story I was telling myself and the story my friends told about me. But my life, my actual life, had to be somewhere else. Surely, my life had to be somewhere else. Maybe with him. I don't know. I felt some warm pressure against my knees. I looked down, and there was a big, goofy-looking dog. He was white and had a slobbery kind of face that seemed to be smiling up at me. He curled into me, and then I could see what he was trying to give me. It was a dead chicken in his mouth, as limp as phlegm but still warm. The dog looked proud and kept trying to hand the bird to me. I let out a long sigh and patted his big blocky head. "Professor Moriarty, I assume," I said to no one in particular. Chapter 2. Embarkation. It was dark on my street. The fish plant was busy with freezer trucks backing up to the loading docks. The wind from the west was blowing the smell from the channel back up onto the streets. Music was coming from the native meeting hall, and a couple of fishermen were walking side by side down the sidewalk. They wore dirty float coats, and they had their red rubber boots rolled down. One was smoking a cigarette, and he nodded to me as I shouldered past him. I was carrying the dead chicken under my arm, and as I walked past the two men, I heard the smoker mutter something, and they both laughed. A truck with a rusted-out back bed and a bad muffler rolled by. I've lived in this particular house for 7 years. It's built out on pilings over the steep, rocky beach. I grew up in an old hunting lodge in Juneau. The home of my childhood was sold years ago. My mother lives in Santa Fe. Our family house is now a bed and breakfast. I stayed there some years ago and even slept in my old room where I had carved my initials on the molding around the closet door. I looked for them, but the molding had been replaced. The room had little baskets of sage on the bedside table and strange-smelling candles burned in the bathroom. This was my childhood bedroom, and now there were old copies of Architectural Digest on a rosewood nightstand next to the frilly four-poster bed. For better or worse, my real life is here in Sitka now with my roommate Todd and Jane Marie D'Angelo. Jane Marie moved from Juneau, nominally to be with me, but the presence of humpback whales in Sitka Sound in the late fall and early winter helped. Jane Marie is a research biologist and the chief executive officer of Playing Around Enterprises. This was her day job so that she could fund her research. Playing Around Enterprises published a journal called, naturally, the Playing Around Review, which featured news, information, and advice on games. Jane Marie was a specialist in games, board games, card games, parlor games, even games to play in a car or boat during a long trip. The review created positive cash flow, but the real money came from her catalog of games and supplies. She took orders from all across the North, Alaska, the Yukon, and even into eastern Canada. She specialized in finding the right games for individual social and cultural climates. She had games suited for Christian families living on the prairies of Saskatoon and anarchist fishermen on the coastal islands of Alaska. She sold game supplies to the Arctic villages and software on the latest computer games to kids all over the North. although whenever she was given a chance, she would try to steer children out of the virtual world and back to the real one. Games, Jane Marie insists, are best played against another human, and suffer when played against machines. She currently has a friend helping her get started with shipping games to the Russian Far East. Games, Jane Marie says, are the way people sort their lives out, and how they learn to appreciate the balance in all of their human relationships. As a species, we have become so over-evolved, entertainment's no longer the subtext of our daily lives, but the reverse has become true. Our lives are the subtext of our entertainments. She maintains that this has been true for a very long time, and that it's not just true for those of the idle rich, but for all of those people who labor during the long days of summer so that they can survive the long northern winters. I opened the door to my house and noticed there was a strange coat hanging on the rack in the entryway. The house, which could usually be counted on for some manic strangeness, was quiet, but for adult voices speaking in a sober tone upstairs in the living room. I carried the dead chicken upstairs by the throat. I had forgotten why I was carrying it, but supposed I needed it for some evidentiary reason. When I cleared the stairs, a well-dressed young man with extremely straight teeth and a nice haircut stood up and strode toward me with his hand outstretched. "Well, here he is, the sleuth himself. Hiya, Cecil, I'm Sonny Walters from Great Circle Lines. Gosh, I'm sure glad to meet ya. You know, I've heard a lot about you." I stepped back and foolishly tried to hide the dead chicken behind my back. Jane Marie spotted my awkward moment and came to my rescue. "I see you've been successful." She flashed a buttery smile and reached around my back. "How our winged thoughts have turned to poultry," she added, then took the pathetic bird and disappeared downstairs toward the utility room. "Mr. Walters wants to talk to you about a case, Cecil." Jane Marie's voice floated up the stairs. "Gosh, a case!" Mr. Walters grinned foolishly and shrugged his shoulders as if he were a child star about to go into his tap dance routine. I sat on the chair that was nearest the wood stove. The stove was cold, but the chair was the closest to me and would force Sonny Walters to sit opposite on the couch. "Well, it's really not a case, I don't think. I suppose it's just a little problem we at the cruise line would like to have, oh, I don't know, fleshed out." "Then you work for a cruise ship?" I said, and I realized that he had already told me that, and so to cover I brushed imaginary crumbs off my lap. I was becoming more and more self-conscious of the dead chicken smell clinging to me. I knew the Great Circle Lines. Their ships had been disgorging travelers onto the streets of town in growing numbers the last few years. Tourism was booming in the island communities of southeastern Alaska. Most of the towns on the coast were changing over from the culture of resource extraction, logging, mining, fishing, to the culture of tourism. The seedy little boardwalk towns were becoming gaudy with the rust and gold of big money. Leisure was Alaska's new resource. "You know, you've got a super place here," Mr. Walters said, looking around the upstairs of my house. There were dish towels scattered on the arms of the couch, and my roommate's laundry was sitting in a heap on the table near the kitchen alcove. I nodded and said nothing, not sure how to acknowledge the superness of my living environment. "Well, here it is, Mr. Younger." Walters turned to me, and his voice dropped a couple of businesslike octaves. "The main office of Great Circle Lines in Miami has authorized me to hire a local investigator. But first, I have to ask, Have you been approached by any other cruise line or shipping company to work for them in the past 5 years? His shift in tone caught me off guard. I shook my head in the negative to indicate either that I hadn't been hired by anyone else, or that I didn't know what the heck he was talking about. Good, he went right on. I just want to make sure. Have you been approached by Empire Shipping out of Singapore? He stared at me, waiting. No, I stumbled. I mean, should I have? Oh, no, no, Mr. Walters waved away the thought. Empire is the company that owns our ship. I was just making certain we weren't, you know, reinventing the wheel here. He stopped again, waiting, but this time there was no thread for me to follow. Oh, I said, conclusively. Well, Mr. Younger, the Great Circle Lines want you to help us in sorting out some complaints they've been receiving over the last few seasons. We need it done, well, you know, discreetly. I'm sure you're used to this kind of thing. Sure. I said it too loudly and too confidently. This was sounding like a real job with a genuine paying client. The thought gave me something of a nervous sugar rush. Sure, I repeated. Oh, yeah, discreet. I bit down on my tongue just to stop yammering. Tell me what you need, Mr. Walters. Oh, call me Sonny. Really, you know, he looked nervously around the room again, and I looked too, just trying to be helpful. I mean, my father was Mr. Walters. He laughed nervously, and I responded nervously. I knew why I was nervous, because I needed this work, but I had no idea what was making Mr. Walters twitch. Well, anyway, the main office has had some complaints about the medical services on one of our ships. It's the Westward. I suppose you've seen her. She really is a lovely ship, really. A converted steamship. I mean, an old cargo ship that was refitted in the 70s. You know, this is a ship with a real soul, the soul of a world traveler. A fine old ship, not just a glitzy hotel. There's a beautiful main salon and a wonderful reading room and a small gaming room, a gym, and a classic old theater down below decks. Mr. Sonny Walters was off and running, having found a comfortable topic. The Westward is just beautiful, really clean, and a great staff, of course. We have a terrific time on her. Of course, there's a lot of work, and that really comes down to me and my staff. I handed him his tea for nothing else than to create a pause in the action. What is it you do, Mr. Walters? His young, square face lit up. Why, I'm the cruise director, Mr. Younger. My staff and I are in charge of the entertainment. I worry about your vacation, so you don't have to. I studied to see if there was any sarcasm creeping into the conversation, but so far I could detect none. Sonny Walters appeared to be a cruising true believer. Sounds dreamy, I said, and sipped my tea. Oh, yes, Sonny went on haltingly. We've had a terrific season so far, but the complaints, I offered. Yeah, well, I frankly don't think there's anything to them. You know, we do all we can, but still the main office wants an independent investigation. Are people getting sick? No, not really. I mean, there are problems. Heck, we have 800 passengers and 300 crew members. There are bound to be some illnesses out at sea. Then I held my palms up in front of me. I was starting to lose my enthusiasm for this case already, and I hadn't heard the first fact. There is just a bit of controversy surrounding our ship's doctor. I waited. Sonny looked down at the wooden floor. He did not go on. Outside, I heard the low mutter of a fishing boat passing by close to the house. From the kitchen, I could hear Jane Marie sharpening a knife on a whetstone. There was a rhythmic shiver to the sound that made me shrug my shoulders and take another sip of tea. I decided to wait Mr. Walters out. "The company wants you to come on board and see for yourself," he said finally. "Are you going to tell me any more?" "Well, here's the deal on that." Sonny looked at me and smiled again with his old college try kind of confidence. "The company, Great Circle, that is, just wants you to come on board the ship and see for yourself, Mr. Younger. You can poke around all you want, enjoy yourself, and experience all of the facilities, including the infirmary." "Of course, the infirmary and the ship's doctor. And if you can't come up with any problems or anything, then, well then, I guess their concerns were unwarranted." I took a deep breath. Of course, there were many things I needed to ask. I could have ticked off a long list of things I knew Sonny wasn't telling me. "Sure, I can do that for you, no problem," was what I said instead. Downstairs, the door banged against the coat rack, and I heard the even, heavy footfalls of my roommate upon the stairs. Toddy came into the room with both arms filled with envelopes from the film developing store. He'd been working all summer long at two jobs, and it seemed that most of his discretionary income had gone into film processing. Todd was 46 years old, and he had just received his first camera. This may have explained his lack of discrimination as a photographer. It seemed that he was trying to document every visual element of his life. He had lost his job at a local restaurant when, according to the manager, Todd had spent too much time engaging the customers in protracted philosophical discussions when he should have been doing salad prep. Now Todd worked as an aide for the local veterinarian and for a landscaping company, where the most minute details of each yard, lot, and trimmed sidewalk had been documented photographically. As a local kid from the neighborhood once noted, "Toddy ain't dumb. He's just smart in his very own way." I am his official guardian, and I have long ago stopped trying to reconcile our differing intelligences. Sonny Walters stood up as Todd came into the room, and Todd stopped short. The envelopes of prints cascaded from his arms and scattered across the floor. Sonny looked alarmed at the scattered photos, but Todd smiled and extended his hand as if nothing of concern had transpired. "Why, hello," Todd said, thrusting his massive hand even closer to Sonny. "Hello," Sonny said tentatively. "Would you like some help with that?" he asked, simultaneously shaking Todd's hand and nodding to the envelopes on the floor. "Oh no, that's okay." Todd smiled again, stared at Mr. Walters, and said nothing. For several long moments, Todd just stood and kept staring while he continued to rock back and forth on the balls of his feet. This, I think, was impressive to Sonny Walters. Todd is just under 6 feet tall, but his height is not that noticeable because he often stands with a pronounced hump in his back. Today he was wearing mustard-colored polyester trousers and a flannel shirt. The trousers were held up well beyond his waist by a pair of red suspenders that had the words "Alaska Lager" written on each one. Todd has what used to be called a crew cut before it was adopted by the young people in black who work in the bookstore coffee shop downtown. But the fashion feature that had defined Todd over the years was his thick black-framed glasses that had broken at the bridge some years ago. His father, who has long disappeared into the taverns of Ketchikan or Aberdeen, effected a repair with two stainless steel screws and a tiny plate that had a sharp edge on the outside corner. To mitigate the plate's sharp edge, Todd had taped the joint with different layers of industrial tape over the years. The whole effect lent Todd the look of a damaged new wave paperboy, kind of the friendly road warrior image favored by some urban youth. Only Todd didn't know that, of course. Finally, Todd bent down and picked up his photographs. He was humming the Sheik of Araby for some unknown reason. So then, do we have a deal? Sonny slapped his hands together, turning away from Todd. How do you want to handle the travel, the expenses? I paused and held my breath for a beat. And my fee. There, I had said it. Sonny smiled like a man flush with cash, which I like to see. Well, the travel will, of course, be fully compensated. Food, stateroom, bar tab would be covered by the ship, and I thought we'd just sign you on as an escort and pay you whatever your fee, in cash, of course, as long as we can come to some reasonable understanding. Of course, I smiled. What kind of escort? Ah, Sonny said professorially, as if he were about to begin his lecture on the finer points of living. Many of our passengers are older women. Women, as you know, are longer lived than men, and many women who like to travel are forced by circumstances to travel alone. The cruise line likes to provide escorts for them. Men of good conversational ability, witty companions, and good dancers. It's a completely honorable thing, Sonny added seriously. Ah, I said in return, in what I hoped was a worldly way. The thought of an open bar tab and foxtrotting the North Pacific with the sporty heiresses of America's industrial wealth was beginning to brighten my spirits. Mr. Walters, Jane Marie's voice came into the room like a clarion call. Do you know why males are generally shorter lived than females? Jane Marie had blood on her hands, and there were feathers clinging to her denim apron. Her dark eyes flashed. Poor Sonny shook his head. By now, Todd was sprawled out on the floor, reviewing the photographs in one of the envelopes. Jane Marie stepped over him. The males of the species are generally shorter-lived because they expend so much of the reserve energy in trying to mate every possible female they come in contact with. Some of this energy goes towards display. Jane Marie walked ever closer to poor Sonny with a bloody knife in her hand, and Sonny tried to take a step backward but was stopped by the wood stove. I stayed put in my chair. Some of this display energy goes into activities you mentioned. She stopped and, holding the knife in her hand, placed her fists on her hips. Her eyes were sparkling now. Dancing, card playing, joke telling, these are all forms of mating ritual and subjects of male display. Then, of course, this male energy is funneled off into aggression when the males are forced to compete for the attention of the females. Jane Marie was smiling sweetly now. But truthfully, Mr. Walters, do you know why men are generally shorter-lived? Sonny, being no fool, shook his head in the negative. Jane Marie let out a long breath and held the bloody knife to his face, still smiling as if she were presenting him with a diploma. It's because the males often die as a result of their dangerous breeding behavior. There was a pause, and again Sonny said, Ah. Then another long pause, and then, So then you're suggesting? Sonny drawled. Your company would benefit greatly by having Cecil accompanied by his mate, Jane Marie replied sweetly. And of course Cecil will benefit because if he goes on a cruise without me, I'd be forced to kill him. She held the knife tightly in her fist and batted her eyelashes. So telephone calls were made, along with some veiled threats and cajoling, and my little nuclear family was off to Vancouver, British Columbia, to board the SS Westward. Actually, it had worked out as a bonanza for Sonny Walters. After Jane Marie put the knife down, he'd remembered that he was shy one lecturer for the cruise. Jane Marie had made a powerful impression with her knowledge of biology, and when he realized she also specialized in game strategy, he offered her a berth for one half of what my salary was to be, which turned out to be more than the other lecturers were going to get, but worth it if he could take it out of my pay. Todd's berth took some cajoling and the rest of my fee. This would have been the second extended trip of his entire life, the first being a trip to Centralia, Washington, which involved an aborted bus trip and a string of bizarre rides on Todd's first-ever hitchhiking experience. But we couldn't leave him alone, mostly because he was rather indiscriminate on who he would invite home, and we couldn't trust that the house wouldn't be overrun with strangers upon our return. During one lunch hour this summer, I came home to find a church group from Indiana having lunch on our wobbly deck out over the channel. Then there was a Filipino gambling society that had to be asked to leave. No, Todd would be making the trip with us. So my fee was forfeited, but there was still the bar tab, the midnight buffets, and the moonlight cuddling on the aft deck, tucked in a blanket with a hot toddy and a wedge of brie and a cracker. Here was the summer of my discontent being made glorious by this Sonny Walters. Of course, I knew he was lying to me. I figured the ship's doctor had probably maimed one of the passengers in some sort of blatant malpractice. The company wanted to fire him, but firing any doctor is problematic, especially one with a sweet gig. The company wanted to know how bad the news was. They needed some ammunition to either fire the doctor or cover the whole thing up. They just wanted a read on it before they had to act. This was fine with me. I'd just try and figure out what they wanted to hear and give it to them. Anything to get me off the island. Anything to forget this summer. We had 2 days to pack and make excuses for unexpectedly putting our real lives on hold for 2 weeks. Vernon Welsh, who ran the landscaping business, was so tickled with the thought of Todd on a cruise ship, he not only gave Todd the time off, he gave him some extra cash to spend on the boat. Then Vernon did something which seemed out of character until just after he had done it. He slipped me a check for $300, pulled me aside, and whispered, "For Christ's sake, get him something decent to wear. It wouldn't be right to have old Todd stick out on that ship like some goddamn retard." I took the money, and Vernon slapped me on the shoulder as if he knew I could keep a secret. Of course, I'm sure Vernon assumed that Todd was a goddamn retard. In fact, once when Todd put diesel fuel into the riding mower, Vernon had used the words himself. But it was in character that Vernon would want Todd to be dignified if he were going on the ship. Dignity is what a tourist town needs most. Dignity is often the first to go. We were to be tourists in our own country. Sitka, Alaska had been the capital of Russian America.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.